Well, good morning, City Church. You guys get up on your feet with us today. Let's worship our God together.
Sometimes you gotta dance through the dark, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta stand on the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere and praise, giving praise, giving praise in the highest. Praise, giving praise, giving praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Sometimes you gotta praise in the prison, cry out to heaven, shout into the door, scream wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high, cause I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of the praise.
We believe he's worthy of praise today. That's what we're singing, City. Let's go. Sing faithful all my life, let me.
Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere and every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. He's faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere and every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. Say praise, give him praise, give him praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all of the praise.
Can you give us some praise this morning? You guys can grab a seat where you're at.
What's up, City fam? Here's your City Minute. At the City, one of our core values is to be a church of mission and justice. We believe God has called us to be on mission with Him as we spread the gospel around the world, as well as becoming defenders of the oppressed, the orphan, the unborn, the widow, the foreigner, the poor, and the prisoner. So, accompanying the primary works of evangelism are ministries of mercy and justice that adorn the gospel we profess. If this is your first time here at City Church, we want to know. If you're here with us in person, you can fill out the connection card in the seat back in front of you and come see us before you leave at the Welcome Center located in the lobby. We'd love to meet you and give you a gift just to say thanks for being here.
Parents of fifth graders, we can't believe your kid is almost a middle schooler. Whether you're super stoked or slightly scared, we want to meet with you. Join us Sunday, May 5th at 10:45 a.m. in the youth room. We'll have donuts and sit down and share with you about all things City Youth. After our meeting, we want your almost sixth grader to join City Youth for our 11:30 a.m. service. Register on the app today.
If you love the City Church and you would consider this to be your church home, then your next step is to become a member. Our next new member lunch is on Sunday, April 28th, after the 11:30 service. We'll provide childcare and lunch. Register on the app.
On May 5th, we'll be having a foster and adoption info meeting after our 11:30 service. If you've ever thought about foster care or adoption, this meeting is for you. We'll hear from a few different agencies in town about how the process works and how you can be involved at any level. There will be plenty of time for questions, and each agency will have a table set up with info packets for you. Lunch and childcare will also be provided. Sign up on the app.
And this has been your City Minute.
Well, good morning, City Church. So glad you guys have joined us today. First-time guests, we'd love to see you at the Welcome Center after our time together today. We'd love to give you a free T-shirt of our way, as our way of saying how excited we are that you've joined us today. Lots of stuff coming up, available to be signed up for and registered for. If you want to do that, if you want to be a part of anything you just heard about, that QR code on the connection card in front of you or the sign-ups tab on the app is the best way to do that. Well, 2 years ago, in December of 2022, we began a two-year journey called Project One. The goal of Project One, the primary goal, is that we would be all in for the vision that God had given us here at the City Church. We said that this wasn't going to be an all gave some or some gave all vision. It was an all in. Our secondary goal was that we would give our all to the vision that God had given us here at the city. And we challenged you, many people, our families, people that attend the city, to begin giving to the city if they hadn't already, or to give above and beyond what they were currently giving to see the vision that God had given us here at the City Church become a reality. And man, we were blown away with the response of how many people stepped up and made commitments financially to the vision of the City Church. You know, one of the other things we were hoping that Project One would lead to is a permanent home for our church. At the time, we were renting the Legacy Event Center behind you across this big parking lot. And then we were hoping that we could put permanent roots down in downtown Lubbock. Maybe a couple weeks into Project One, we were able to put a contract on this building and moved in July of last year. And man, it has just been incredible to see all that God has done. Well, the very first Sunday that we were here in this building, Emily attended our church for the very first time. And she has a really cool story to tell. So check this out.
Very first service here, I felt his presence for the first time ever in my life. And God has impacted me in so many ways since starting here. He has moved so much in the past 7-8 months that I can't even count on my fingers and toes how many blessings I've had. Being a single mom, I knew I needed that community. I knew I needed that support, and being supported through all the other single moms in this community, in our church, and just the way this church gives back spiritually, emotionally, even financially, it has impacted my life so much where I feel so confident and I feel so loved here, and so does my son. He comes to church and he sees people and he goes, "Hey, look who it is." He has a family here. From my first service I attended, I felt God's presence next to me in that seat, to when we were going over the Holy Spirit, and I just broke down in tears about the way God has moved in me in that short amount of time, and the way that I desired God so much, to the day where I was baptized and dedicated my son within the same 10-15 minutes. And I just have had multiple significant spiritual moments that I can never be more thankful for. God has taught me, as a single mom with my Project One commitment, it's just like the widow in the temple when he's talking to the Pharisees and the religious leaders and his people. She gave the bare minimum, but from the outside, but that was everything she had. And he found that amazing. And it's learning, God has taught me that I might not be able to give tons and tons, but it means more to him than anything. Being uncomfortable so I can give back to God what he is deserved, what this church can use in order to create more disciples. And that is a sacrifice I've had to learn how to make, but it has already come into fruition that these sacrifices are actually allowing me a more comfortable life. Different things have happened that have shown his faithfulness and that he will take care of me and my son through everything, including the very first single mom Sunday. during service, all the single moms will get up and the congregation just basically gives whatever they can to the single moms financially, however much they want, can, or need to. And that filled me up with so much love and spirit and God saying, see, I told you. I went home and I just cried my eyeballs out with how incredible this church has been, and just the proof of God's obedience, of the obedience to God, that no matter what you do, even if you feel like you're struggling, He will be here for you. You know, if I could talk to the people that made that initial Project One, I would just give them all each an individual hug and tell them how thankful I am, because if it were not for their initial sacrifices, I probably would have never grown in my relationship with God. I probably never would have gotten baptized, probably would never would have dedicated Wyatt. It is incredible, and I am so thankful for it. I really am thankful for this church. I've had some pretty rough times lately, and if it weren't for this church, I don't know how I would have made it. There are days when I can barely make it out of bed, so I roll into church in yoga pants and no makeup on, but I still feel loved and accepted anyways, and I couldn't get that anywhere else, and I'm so thankful for that.
Can we give Emily a hand for sharing that with us? Awesome. She's also going to come in and give everyone a hug now, like she said she was going to do in the video. Hey, man, so many lives, families have been touched and changed through those of you who have made Project One commitments. So thank you so much for staying strong and remaining faithful in those commitments. And maybe you've joined the city in the last few months and you've said, hey, like, this is where we want to be. This is where we want to plant our family. This is where we want to grow and chase Jesus. Man, I challenge you with the same challenges we gave the church 2 years ago. Go all in with the city. You heard in the city, man, there's 175 things right now, man, to get signed up for or to get plugged into our church through. And secondly, give, right? Help us continue the vision that God has given us for the city church, to be downtown, to minister to people here and all around the world in the name of Jesus. If you want to begin giving, if that's something that you're interested in, you can go to the giving tab on our app. It's at the bottom. There's also a giving tab on our website. We'd love for you to be a part of Project One in that way. Let's do our City 7 today. We are on City 7 number 6. And for those of you who don't know, the City 7 are 7 foundational truths, questions and answers that tell us why we believe what we believe as followers of Jesus. We do them in here, our kids ministry and our youth ministry, because we want to produce followers of Jesus, disciples who know why they believe what they believe. So I'll read the question and then together we'll answer. So the question is this: is the Bible God's word? And the answer is this. Let's read. Jesus proved He is God by rising from the dead and said the Old Testament was God's word, and gave authority to the apostles to write the words of the New Testament under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, so that all the words of the Bible are God's word. Our statement of beliefs on our website says this about the Bible, and I just love the picture. The Bible is God's word to all men and contains God's self-revelation. It was written by human authors under the supernatural inspiration and guidance of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, being God, quoted from every portion of the Old Testament, saying it was God's word, and then gave the apostles alone the authority to write the words of Scripture. Therefore, it is the supreme source of truth that Christian beliefs, for Christian beliefs and living. Because it is inspired by God, it is truth without any mixture of error. And we're gonna pray and ask God to bless our time together. So would you bow your heads with me? And let's ask Him. Jesus, we thank You so much for, God, the opportunity we have today to come to worship You, to hear from Your word. God, thank You for reminding us of the truth that we find in Your word, God, that it is from You. God, You say in Your word that those who belong to You gladly listen to Your words. God, I pray that we could gladly listen to Your instructions today, Lord. Holy Spirit, open our eyes and our ears to see You, to hear You. God, correct us in ways that we're off. Encourage us in ways where we're strong. And God, just hearing Emily's story again, God, I'm just so reminded of what You're doing in our church. God, through the families here, God, I just want to say thank You. God, we are honored that You would choose to use us, that You would choose to move in our church. God, we ask that you would continue to do that. God, we thank you for every gift that was given in the lobby, that will be given in the lobby today, or anything that was given online this past week. Lord, we pray that you would bless those offerings in your name. God, we realize that as people give, God, that is them worshiping you. God, they're bringing their first and their best as a worship to you, Lord. And so we acknowledge that. God, ask that we could be good stewards of those funds here at the city. God, you'd help us to make disciples with them here in Lubbock and all around the world. Be with us in this time, Lord. God, we submit to you. Have your way. Amen. Would you guys stand up with us as we continue singing? We're going to teach you a new song. Man, this is an amazing prayer for those of us who want to follow Jesus.
Yes, I deep. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. So draw me close and teach me to be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my pride. I am yours forever. Draw me close and teach me to
any hurt, any answer. God, I pray that would be all of our hearts posture today as we come into the service, that it wouldn't just be about getting something from you. It wouldn't be about checking some kind of box in our own lives to make us feel better about ourselves, but God, that we would just have a posture today of submission to you because we trust you. We just say that at the outset today, God, we trust you because we know that you are faithful and you will never fail. You're incapable of failing us. So God, even if we don't fully see the whole picture, even if we don't fully understand, we just trust you, God. We trust you. We pray right now in this moment for Clayton. We thank you for good reports. God, we thank you that you're moving in his life. We thank you that these tumors are shrinking. And God, we just ask right now that you surround Clayton and the whole family, God, just with your peace, your love. God, that even in this moment, they would know that you're with them. We pray for just continued healing in the name of Jesus. And God, we ask that you speak to us today. God, speak to our hearts. Tweak us. God, maybe even set us in a brand new direction. We're here to open your word, to read the word of God, to hear the Holy Spirit speaking to us, and to be challenged, to be changed. And so God, I just pray you would do the work in us that only you can do today. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You guys can have a seat. Welcome to the city. My name is Brandon. I'm one of the pastors here. If you're new, if this is your first time, we haven't met yet, I'd love to meet you. But I hope you guys had a great Easter. Hope you got to spend a lot of time with family. And that's if you wanted to spend time with family. If you didn't want to spend time with family and you had to, I'm sorry that happened to you. But, you know, we've all been there. I got to spend time with my parents. They came over for dinner that last Easter night, last Sunday. And they're not here this morning, which is perfect timing for the story that I'm about to tell. But I had great parents growing up. You know, we were probably pretty traditional in the sense that my dad was the primary disciplinarian, right? My mom was more of the softer one. But my dad was a cotton farmer. So I grew up on a farm around farm equipment, tractors, and all that stuff. Like, we were country folks. And I was probably 9 or 10 or so. I remember it was a Sunday afternoon. And Sunday afternoons, if you grew up like me, were for naps, okay? That's what you did between Sunday morning church and Sunday night church. You took a nap in the middle, right? Because you had to, I don't know, get your energy back up for the church again. I don't know. We had church in one day. Can you believe it? Two churches, two times in one day. So I was supposed to be taking a nap, but of course I wasn't. I was messing around outside, and I had two buddies that were neighbors of mine, the only neighbors I ever had in my life, and they only lived there for like 2 years. We were out there playing on the tractors, okay? And what we like to do is get in the tractor and turn the key just enough to get it to kind of the radio to come on, you know, and you can kind of feel like you're driving the tractor or whatever. And we were each in a different one, and we thought we were something else. Well, this particular day, I turned the key too far, and it started the tractor, right? No big deal. Just turn it off, right? What I didn't know then was you can't just kill a tractor by turning off the key. These older tractors, you had to manually choke them, right? Like, you had to pull a manual choke to get it shut down. I did not have this information at the time, okay? So the problem was I was going to need help shutting down this tractor from someone. And the only one I could think of was a big, burly farmer man that was enjoying his sacred Sunday nap. So I had to go in and wake up my dad and tell him that I had started the tractor and I couldn't shut it down. Now, I'm not sure what your beliefs are about spanking, but my dad was a huge supporter, okay? Like, he believed in it. And he wasn't a banker. He didn't wear a banker's belt. He wore a farmer's belt, okay? And let me just tell you, I got one of the biggest whoopings of my life. I mean, I will never forget it. And guess what else never happened again? I never did that. I never started a tractor again. Of course, if I had, I would have known how to turn it off, so it would have been fine. But I never did it again. It was the fear of punishment meant I was never making that mistake again. Now, this is something that was facing Peter and John in Acts chapter 4. Not spankings from my dad, but they found themselves in trouble with the very same crew that Jesus did, right? They had just seen Jesus walk through this whole thing of getting arrested and this sham trial, and they saw him executed. And now in Acts 4, they're going to find themselves in front of the very same people and getting threatened. And we get to kind of see how they choose to respond. And if you don't know, we're going verse by verse through the book of Acts. And really, you know, when you look at Acts, you're looking at the birth of the church. These are the very first Jesus followers. And so if we as Christians are going to do things the right way, follow Jesus the right way, I think looking at the book of Acts, looking at the apostles, the very first church, this is a great place to start, to kind of model ourselves after these very first Christians, after, in this case, Peter and John. I think it's a great thing for us to try to emulate them. The things they did, how they talked, where they went, what they thought was important. These are all things that should mark our lives as well. And I know for me, as I'm reading through the book of Acts, man, I want to ask myself, how does my life measure up to what they were all about? And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to get a look at Peter and John kind of getting their very first taste of persecution for the gospel and what they do in response. So we're going to be in Acts chapter 4. If you have your Bibles, if not, as always, they're on the screen. The best way to follow along with the messages is in our app under message notes. All the verses are there, the points are there, some fill in the blank stuff too. I've asked my friend Tony to read the scripture for us this morning. So if you guys would stand just in the honor of the reading of God's word, Tony.
Good morning. I'm Tony Arnold. My wife Terry and I have four wonderful daughters. Next month, we'll get a third son-in-law. And in August, we get to meet our second grandson. So my wife volunteers in City Kids. I'm part of the safety team, and we attend the Gilliam group. So let's go to Acts 4. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, they were confronted by the priest, the captain of the temple guard, and some of the Sadducees. These leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people that through Jesus, there is a resurrection of the dead. They arrested them, and since it was already evening, put them in jail until morning. But many of the people who heard their message believed it. So the number of men who believe now totaled about 5,000.
Awesome. Thanks, Tony. You guys can have a seat. So that was only four verses. We've got a long way to go. We're covering 31 today. So buckle up. It's going to be a lot of reading. Peter and John, you remember last week, as Clayton shared, if you missed that message, man, go back and watch it. It was so incredibly powerful. But they had healed this paralytic man, somebody that was born paralyzed. And this is kind of the fallout from that healing, right? They're confronted by the priest, the captain of the temple guard, the Sadducees. So the captain of the temple guard was second in command to the high priest. And then you have the Sadducees. They're another kind of sect of these religious leaders. So basically, the Sadducees didn't like what happened, and they called security on Peter and John. So the Sadducees are a little different than the Pharisees. The Pharisees were all about piety and making sure all the rules were followed, even rules that they had come up with on their own. Sadducees, a little bit different. They were loyal to the Roman government. They're very aristocratic. They loved playing the game. They were in it for power and for money and for influence. And they, because of that, and because Rome was in charge, they were all about keeping the peace and to keep having favor with the Roman government. They were very materialistic, again, less devoted to piety than the Pharisees. But these Sadducees and the captain of the guard and all this stuff, probably some of the very same officials that had just executed Jesus. Pharisees, so if you look back at Jesus' ministry, it was the Pharisees that he was kind of butting heads against, you know, constantly. They were the ones he was calling out constantly, but now it's kind of shifted. The Pharisees have kind of taken a back seat, and now it's the Sadducees that are up in arms about what's going on with the apostles. And if you remember from the study of Luke, we talked about them a while back, the Sadducees in particular. They only believed in the Pentateuch, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and that was it. A little different belief system, but they didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in the spirit world or miracles or the resurrection. Not just Jesus' resurrection, but resurrection from the dead. So they live with no hope of the resurrection, no heaven, no eternity. And that's why the Sadducees were sad, you see, right? That's a dad joke that every preacher is obligated to tell when it comes to the Sadducees. But you see where the rub is kind of happening here, right? Like their whole belief system is being challenged right here in front of their eyes, because not only did they not believe in healing, which they had just seen happen, but they didn't believe in the resurrection. And that's what they were preaching and teaching, was that Jesus was resurrected from the dead. It went against everything that they stood for. But even more than their belief system, again, it goes beyond that, because they want to keep their power. And that means keeping the peace. So that everything they're trying to do, they're trying to handle it quickly and quietly. They're trying to navigate this situation carefully. They would love nothing more than to just disappear them, right? To make them go away, to kill them. But they know that would cause some upheaval, some rioting, because again, the people were buying in. And they had just seen this man get healed. And that all happened in broad daylight in front of everyone. And we just read in verse 4 that a ton of people saw this and believed, right? And so the number of believers is now up to 5,000. And this is men, right? They only counted men in these days. The estimation of Jerusalem's population at this time, it can vary between 25,000 all the way up to 85,000, okay? The higher number is probably more accurate due to recent studies. Also, in this area, there were about 6,000 Pharisees total, right? And so a total of 5,000 Jewish Christian men is a big deal. Like, this thing is taking off fast, and it's growing at a fast rate, and it's a big problem for people that wanted to see it die. So verse 5, let's keep reading. The next day, the council of all the rulers and elders and teachers of the religious law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, along with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other relatives of the high priest. They brought in the two disciples and demanded, "By what power or in whose name have you done this?" All right, this is a big deal. By what power, like in whose name are you doing this? This is a loaded question, because they know they didn't give them the authority to be doing the things they were doing. And because of their belief system and their belief in God and miracles didn't exist or whatever, it couldn't have been God either, right? So who, by whose power are they healing? Because they can't argue the fact that the guy is healed. So it had to be some kind of demonic force. So they're kind of setting them up here. They're trying to get them to say something that would kind of seal their fate, to give them a reason to execute them in their mind. They wanted to stone them. And if you remember back in verse 2, that it just said that these guys were disturbed, very disturbed by the message of the apostles. Disturbed. And that's what the gospel does to people, doesn't it? It disturbs them. The gospel is the great stumbling block. To tell someone the truth of the gospel, to come to the point where we have to admit that we are sinners and we can't get to God, we can't have a relationship with him on our own, that we need a savior. That's a difficult thing to swallow, that there's only one way to the Father. They were disturbed. But then in verse 8, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them. So just pause here for a second. Why is Luke pointing this out? He could have just said, Peter said to them. But he said, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to him. He's pointing this out because this is a different Peter. Something has happened to Peter. He has a conviction that he's never had before. There's something different going on, and he's about to fill us in as to why. Peter says to them, "Rulers and elders of our people, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for a crippled man? Do you want to know how he was healed? Let me clearly state to all of you and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, the man you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead. For Jesus is the one referred to in scriptures where it says, the stone you builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. I mean, can you imagine? Again, don't lose the context here. Peter is standing in front of these guys that just killed the Messiah, and he's being threatened and questioned, and this is one of the boldest sermons I've ever heard in my life, right? I mean, he's going at them full force. He says, let me clearly state, right? The man you crucified, you killed, that was God's Messiah. God raised him from the dead. It's like when your wife says, can we talk? Like, you know the next thing that comes out of her mouth is not gonna be good, right? Like, it puts you on edge a little bit. This is what he's saying. He's saying, like, listen to me. Let me clearly state here, you are the one that murdered him. And then he's quoting scripture to them. You're the ones that rejected this stone. You're the builders that rejected the stone that's now become the cornerstone. You are on the wrong side of God's plan. He's making an extremely logical point here, like drawing attention to the irony. He's like, listen, you're accusing us of doing a good deed, of healing this man, like we're in trouble, while you're the one who actually committed murder. It doesn't make sense. Peter's like, am I the only one seeing this, you know? He says, it was you. You're on the wrong side of God's plan. And again, you have to think that Peter and John know exactly what's happening here. They know what could happen as a result of the words that they're saying in this moment. They know what could be coming their way. They just witnessed Jesus walk down this very same road. And they have to be hearing the words of Jesus as he told them before he left. As my Father sent me, so I am sending you. They hate me. They're going to hate you even more. They had to be realizing that Jesus was right. It was happening just like he said. And I don't know about you, but that would make me a little bit nervous, a little on edge. So what has gotten into Peter and John? A couple of things. First, they were firm. They were fixed. They were steadfast. They were certain of their faith. There was like a new certainty that was there that hadn't been there before. So what has changed? Well, they saw Jesus alive. That would do it, right? Seeing brings certainty. This wasn't a blind Christian faith kind of thing. That they're not just blazing this trail here with these religious leaders based on some rumor they heard. They saw with their own eyes. They touched him with their own hands. And you know what the cool part is it's the same for us. The disciples didn't believe on blind faith. In fact, it took seeing him to believe. And we don't have to take it on blind faith either. We talk about this all the time. It's one of our City Seven that there's historical evidence inside and outside of the Bible that Jesus lived. He did miracles. He died on a Roman cross, and then multiple believers of his died horrible deaths claiming they saw him alive. They were fixed. They were sure. They were certain. They were also faithful. They were obedient. Even in the face here of possible imprisonment, possible death, they didn't water down the message. They could have said, look, guys, you know, we know you didn't mean it, right? If you could take it back, we know that you would. Everyone makes mistakes. They could have said, you know, we understand Jesus was really pushing your buttons, right? Like the whole hypocrite, brood of vipers, whitewashed tomb stuff. They could have been like, we get it, right? But they didn't do that. They gave them both barrels of truth, unashamed gospel truth. They didn't water it down. They didn't tiptoe around it. They faced it head on because they were fearless. They were fearless. Luke points out that Peter, he's kind of trying to make a contrast here. Peter is a different Peter. Again, this is the same temple. Rewind the clock just a little bit when Jesus has been dragged in and is on trial. The same temple, the same courtyard, the same officials. Something has happened to Peter. This is the guy that denied he even knew Jesus a few weeks ago. So what happened to him and the others? Well, they were filled. They were filled with what? With the Holy Spirit. And yes, Pentecost happened. We read about Pentecost and when the Spirit fell for the first time. And of course, they have the Holy Spirit. But this is an infilling of the Holy Spirit. We talked about this when we did the Holy Spirit series, that how we're filled once at regeneration, right? When we give our lives to Jesus. But we should also seek to be filled continuously. God, give me a fresh filling, a fresh infilling of your Holy Spirit, a fresh anointing to do your work, to do your will. So Jesus had told them this is exactly what would happen, right? He told them, don't worry about what you're going to say when you get dragged in front of the officials, because he said the promised Holy Spirit will be with you, in you, and will give you the words to say. That's what we're witnessing right now. They were ready for this moment, filled with the Holy Spirit and for boldness. Peter has now gone from the courtyard, staying warm by a fire, denying he knew Jesus to a little girl, and now is inside, consumed with the fire of the Holy Spirit, confronting the men that killed the Savior of all of mankind face to face. That's what the Holy Spirit can do. He went from denying to knowing Jesus to defying those that murdered him. That man you crucified. That is a transformation. And that's the result of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Just like what was tongues of fire that had rested on each of their heads at Pentecost, now their hearts are on fire for the truth of the gospel. It burns on the inside of them. It's what their lives are now devoted to, built upon. What's gotten into them? It's the Holy Spirit. And so what's the result? Verse 13. The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. For they could see they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. So they were amazed, right? Because they saw with their own eyes. They recognized, like, these are... Some translations say uneducated men. That doesn't mean they're dummies. They're just saying they haven't been trained in their rabbinic process, right? They don't have the theological training to be this bold as they're speaking about the gospel. But here's the key. They also recognize them as men who had been with Jesus. They had been with Jesus. They were different now. They had been with Jesus. The Sadducees had to be thinking, maybe there's a connection here, right? Maybe that's why these men are different. These were the guys that were walking around with Jesus. Something has happened in them. What greater evidence of Jesus being a savior than a changed life, a transformation? The lame walk, the blind see, hearts are transformed. Verse 14. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing right there among them, there was nothing the council could say. So they ordered Peter and John out of the council chamber and then conferred among themselves. What should we do with these men? They asked each other. We can't deny they have performed a miraculous sign, and everybody in Jerusalem knows all about it. But to keep them from spreading their propaganda any further, we must warn them not to speak to anyone in Jesus' name again. So they called the apostles back in and commanded them to never again speak or teach in the name of Jesus. So they give them the stern warning, like, this is over, dudes. Like, we can't deny what everyone has seen and heard, but do not do it again. No more. No more gospel, no more Jesus, no more any of it. And what they expected to hear is probably what my dad expected to hear, right? Yes, sir. Yes, sir, we won't. We won't do that anymore. I mean, they had to be thinking, the Sadducees, you've seen what we do to people that defy us. Like, what other conclusion could they come to other than these dudes are going to bow down to us? They're going to fold. But that's not what they got. And what they heard next had to have shocked them. Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling everything we have seen and heard." And my goodness, this is the coolest part of the story to me. Who do you think you are? That's what they're telling these religious leaders. You think God wants us to obey you rather than him? So they're telling them, you're not on God's side again, right? And they're blatantly defying them. Who are you to stand up to God's sovereign plan? This reminds me of David and Goliath. If you remember David, this skinny little teenager shepherd boy marches out into this field to face this giant and says, "Who is this Philistine that defies the army of the living God?" That is boldness. They were compelled. Their convictions compelled them. That the Holy Spirit in them filling them with supernatural boldness. We can't stop. We won't stop telling what we have seen and heard. That's the best definition of a witness. Speaking the things you have seen and heard. What about you? You know, if you find it difficult to speak to what the Lord has done in your life, maybe you haven't seen or heard much from him. Verse 21. The council then threatened them further, but they finally let them go because they didn't know how to punish them without starting a riot. For everyone was praising God for this miraculous sign, the healing of the man who had been lame for more than 40 years. So once again, this sign, this healing of this paralytic man, it did what signs do. It pointed to something greater. And the people recognized it and they were praising God. So now what? What do Peter and John do? Where do they turn? What do they do next? They've been threatened and threatened again. Now what do? We see in verse 23. As soon as they were freed, Peter and John returned to the other believers and told them what the leading priests and elders had said. When they heard the report, all the believers lifted their voices together in prayer to God. O sovereign Lord, creator of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. You spoke long ago by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant, saying, why were the nations so angry? Why did they waste their time with futile plans? The kings of earth prepared for battle. The rulers gathered together against the Lord and against his Messiah. In fact, this has happened here in this very city. For Herod, Antipas, Pontius Pilate, the governor, the Gentiles, and the people of Israel were all united against Jesus, your holy servant, whom you anointed. But everything they did was determined beforehand according to your will. And now, O Lord, hear their threats and give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. Stretch out your hand with healing power. May miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. After this prayer, the meeting place shook and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Then they preached the word of God with boldness. So, what's the first thing they did when they found themselves seemingly backed into a corner or in trouble? They prayed. That was their immediate response, to pray. They didn't picket or riot or get involved politically or put up a banner or post on Facebook or leave a nasty Google review, right? They went straight to the Father. They didn't just do it alone. They came back to their community of believers. They came back to the people they were doing life with, the other believers. And they were like, we know exactly what to do. And more than that, we know who to turn to. They immediately expressed their dependence on God, and they were unified in that. This is a theme of the early church. We've said it over and over again. Godly community doing life together, seeking God together, following Jesus together, praying together. And they also give us, in this prayer, it's a beautiful thing. They kind of give us a pattern for prayer. I want to talk about just for a second. The pattern of prayer. First of all, it had backing. How'd they start their prayer? Oh, sovereign Lord. So they're addressing the God of the universe, who they're acknowledging is sovereign, who's in control. The word they use there for Lord in the original language, it's a rare one, actually. It's only happened 5 times in the New Testament. It's despotes. It actually means dictator. Like absolute ruler, right? The one who is absolutely in control of everything. That's who they're acknowledging, they're talking to. Like, you are God. You can do anything. You're the creator of the heavens and the earth and the seas and everything in them. It's this kind of prayer, if we were to let this sink in just a little bit, this kind of prayer, if you start off acknowledging who you're talking to, it does something in you. It stirs up your faith just a little bit that, listen, I'm talking to a God that can do anything. I'm not just throwing up some weak, feeble, half-hearted prayer. I'm addressing the throne. This is who we're addressing in prayer. It should bring some confidence, some faith, to boldness to pray for big things. Their prayer had a backing, and that was God himself. It also had a basis in what? Scripture. In their prayer, they quote scripture. They quote this Psalm 2, a scriptural basis for what they're asking for and who they're asking. They said, God, your word says. See, prayers based in God's truth are powerful prayers. Because why? They're in line with God's truth, his revealed will. As long as you're not taking that verse out of context and using it in your own ways, right? But they're pointing back to prophecy here. God, this is part of your story. We are part of your story. It's not about us or our plan or our ways or what we think. God, this is your plan for your glory. It also had balance. This prayer, again, if you notice, it didn't just ask for stuff. Did you notice that? Didn't just ask. They started by worshiping God, like giving him adoration. Oh, sovereign Lord, you rule everything. You are awesome. Just like Jesus taught in the Lord's Prayer. You remember when he said, when you pray, do it like this. How did it start? Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. God, you are a holy God. It didn't just start off asking for things. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Then, give us this day our daily bread. We've talked about this some in previous years, especially at our prayer gatherings, the Acts model of prayer. Acts, in this case, is not talking about the book of Acts, but an acronym, Acts, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, then supplication. Like when we pray, we shouldn't just jump into, oh, Lord, help me, right? Acknowledge who we're talking to, worship him, confession of sin, thanksgiving, and then asking God for help. I mean, any parent can relate to that, right? Who wants their kid only coming to them when they need something? But how often do we treat God that way? Next, it had bearing. It had a specific direction. It was asking for specific things, not just throwing out like ambiguous Christianese phrases, right? Like, bless us, Lord, or throw up a hedge of protection or a ring of fire around us, or protect your holy and anointed ones. It specifically asked for two things. First, for more miracles that would point to God getting glory, life change, more believers. And secondly, they prayed for boldness. Boldness. They didn't pray for revenge or protection or blessing. They didn't even pray for wisdom, how to handle the situation. They didn't even pray for God's will in the situation. Why? Because they knew what his will was. They prayed for boldness. They knew what they had to do, and they asked for all they needed to do it. Can you imagine? I mean, think about that. I could get, you know, praying for boldness, but I might also throw in, help me not die, right? There was none of that. God, give me boldness. Which is crazy, because it's the boldness that just got them in trouble to begin with. So here's the loop. They're filled with the Spirit. They preach with boldness. They heal the guy, got arrested, threatened. Then they pray for more boldness. Then they get filled with the Spirit again, and it says they spoke the word of God with more boldness. That's the pattern of the church in Acts. Does that look like our lives? Here's our challenge today. Again, we're talking about building our lives off of what we see in the apostles and the first believers in the book of Acts. They give us a blueprint here. Build from the blueprint. This should be the blueprint of our lives. No matter what your vocation is, your occupation, your personality, male, female, your age, it doesn't matter. This is who we're meant to be, because this is who lives in us. The same Spirit that was filling Peter and John in those moments is the same Spirit that's in us. And their mission on this earth is the same as our mission on this earth. Nothing has changed. This should be the pattern of our lives, who we're meant to be. Number one, they had been with Jesus. That's where it starts. These men had been with Jesus. People saw and recognized those guys have been with Jesus. They were amazed. When people look at your life, can they say, man, they've been with Jesus. There's something different about them. Do you have a relationship with Jesus? Because if not, that's step one. Like we talked about Peter and John, the other apostles, like having that faith that was based in evidence. They saw Jesus. They believed. Have you come to the point where you've been disturbed by that gospel message, that the stumbling block? Have you been to the point where you realize, like, you can't do this life alone? You can't have a relationship with God alone. You have a sin problem. Have you made the decision to trust in Jesus for the payment, his payment of your fine? Have you put your faith in him? Have you made him not just savior of your life, but Lord of your life? Because if you haven't, you can start there today in this moment. God has been pursuing you your entire life. He loves you. He wants a relationship with you. All you've got to do is bow, bend the knee, submit to him. Start a relationship with Jesus, man. It'll change your life, but it's so much bigger than even just this life. We're talking about eternity here. You can be sure today. Make that decision to trust in Jesus. He died for you. He paid the fine for your sins. He rose from the dead. And now you have a right, you have a way to be made right with God. They had been with Jesus. They were united with other believers. That's where they turned when things started going sideways. They didn't just run off to a cave by themselves. They went back to their community of believers. Do you have that community in your life? Someone you hang out with, do life together with, seek Jesus together with, read God's word with, pray together. That's why we do city groups. That's, in my opinion, the most important thing we do. You can't get real discipleship, right? Real accountability, real intimacy, like relationships. Those things can't happen on a Sunday morning. There's just too many of us. So maybe that's your next step. Get in a city group. You can check that box on the app and I'll be in touch with you. They were filled with the Spirit. When was the last time you prayed to be filled with the Spirit? God, fill me afresh. Fill me with your spirit. How long has it been? Like, let my life display the fruits of the spirit. And then they prayed for boldness. When was the last time you prayed for boldness? Like, don't you think that early church, the one we're reading about in the book of Acts, they don't you think they had needs? I'm sure they had financial issues, sickness. They probably had relational problems. And of course, God wants us to bring those things to him. I'm not saying that, right? But what we see over and over and over and over again is that the driving force of their prayer was boldness to share the gospel. It's almost like that was the driving force of their lives, kind of the hub that everything else spun around. When's the last time you prayed for boldness to share the gospel? And this is our big idea today I want to leave you with. Boldness is the courage to speak up when fear tells me to shut up. The courage to speak up when fear says to shut up. I mean, Peter and John, the logical thing for them to do would be to shut up, right? But what was their response? We can't stop telling what we've seen and heard. Do you have the faith, the convictions like Peter and John that can stand up in the face of persecution? Look, I know we don't know a whole lot about persecution in our culture, but we very well might very soon. Do you have the kind? That's what we've been asking this question over and over and over the last 2 or 3 years. That's why we're so big about discipleship and knowing why we believe the things we believe, because we want the kind of faith that can stand up under pressure, under persecution, or at the very least, stand up to culture or your friends or your family and say, you think I should obey you rather than God? I can't stop. I won't stop telling the things that I've seen and heard. Listen, if you find it difficult to speak what the Lord has done in your life, again, maybe you haven't seen or heard much from him. Do you feel persecuted for your faith? If so, you're probably doing something right. And if not, I would ask you, why not? When we live our lives out loud for Jesus, there will be consequences to that. Maybe not as severe as imprisonment or execution, but we will experience a certain level of persecution. If you're not sensing any persecution in your life for your bold stand, for your following Jesus, maybe you might be finding yourself agreeing more with culture than God's word, than Jesus. What would happen if we all were filled with the Holy Spirit, fearless, faithful to the gospel message? What if we had that same can't stop, won't stop determination and conviction? Like, what might be possible? I just want to invite you to just bow your heads, close your eyes, and let's just have a moment of prayer here together before God. And I'm going to ask you something. You know, when we talk about boldness and the courage to speak up when fear tells me to shut up and being compelled and the can't stop, won't stop thing, and how does your life measure up to what we're reading here in Acts 4? And I want to challenge you. I'm going to ask you a question, and I want to encourage you that this is your first step of boldness. If you are one and you're just convicted by all of this, and you're like, man, my life is not being lived out loud for Jesus. I'm not praying for the Holy Spirit to fill me. I'm kind of doing my own thing. My life doesn't revolve around the gospel and living that everywhere I go and everyone I talk to. If if that's you and you would say, God, I want to make a stand today, to make a turn, to make a change. God, I want to live my life out loud. God, I want to live a bold life for you where I can't stop, won't stop telling of what I've seen and heard. If you want a new life, a new infilling of the Spirit, and to live out loud with boldness like we see with Peter and John, I want to ask you in this moment to slip your hand up so we can pray for you. God, we pray for the ones here that are saying, I want to take a stand. God, give me the courage to speak up when fear tells me to shut up. Give me boldness through the power of your Spirit that I might stand firm on the truth. Father, I pray that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit, with new levels of just conviction and boldness for the things that they believe, that they wouldn't be tempted to hide things or to water things down or to soften the gospel message, but they would be full of just courage that comes from your Holy Spirit. God, they would rely on you for when to say things and what to say. Living their lives out loud, not behind closed doors, but devoting their lives to the sharing of the gospel through the boldness of the Holy Spirit. God, do a work in all of our hearts today. We want to live for you, no matter the cost. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us and sing? The name above every other name.
Amen. It's crazy when we begin to pray like they did in the book of Acts, we'll begin to see results like they did in the book of Acts. But in the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit was leading them to share the gospel with other people. He was leading them to go and pray for other people, to give to other people, to be a blessing to other people. Hey, I want to encourage you this morning. I just have an impression this morning. I think it's for more than one person, but I know specifically it's for at least one of the guys with a cap on in here this morning. I don't know which specific one. I just kind of saw that image, but I think it's for multiple people. But here's the gist of it. Don't deny somebody giving something to you. The Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good pleasure, pressed over. Somebody quote me this verse. Okay. Come on, you Bible scholars in here. It's good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So when you give, there's a blessing on you to give. And when you say, hey, no, I don't want that, you rob them of being able to receive a blessing from God for their giving. So somebody's trying to give to you. Don't deny them giving to you. Allow them to give to you. I'm going to pray over us one more time. God, thank you for that message from Acts. Lord, that we would have boldness. Lord, that we would supernaturally have boldness beyond what we naturally would feel. God, that feeling in us that tells us to shut up, Lord, that boldness would push us beyond that. Lord, help us to take the kingdom to our city, even to the nations, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in us and through us, Lord. We give you all the glory. Lord, just bless people as they go today. In Jesus' name, amen. There are prayer teams up here at the front if anybody would like prayer for anything.